Success Connection on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown University Small Business Development Center.
Hi guys, welcome to today's BCTV segment. Today's topic will revolve around self-improvement in the workplace. My name is Amanda Fink and I work for Kutztown University Small Business Development Center. I'm a graduate assistant. Today I have the pleasure of speaking with Angela Hensley, a new KUSBDC staff member. So welcome aboard, Angela.
Thank you.
Would you mind introducing yourself to the camera and talking briefly about your job history so far and why you're here today?
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me. My name is Angela Hensley, and I work as the Workforce Development and Special Programs Coordinator. Big, long title, but through the SBDC, I counsel and assist businesses with developing their workforce and what that actually means to them. I've been working in this field for almost 20 years, so I've worked at many other locations and for the state, and I'm very pleased to be at Kutztown now.
I'm really excited to start working with you, aside from the restrictions that COVID has given us today, but I look forward to working with you.
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome. So can you elaborate on what it looks like to develop a strong workforce?
You first asked me to do this interview, I thought, well, you know, a big thing with me is research. So bear with me for a moment. I looked online and I thought, okay, let's see what the technical description is. It says workforce development is designed by preparing workers with the skills necessary for a specific job. It prioritizes the value of ongoing workplace education and skills development, as well as addressing the hiring demands of the employer. That's a lot of words for workforce development. What I've discovered is that employees over the years, our employers and their training departments and human resource departments have learned that they have to expand. Employees are not staying at the same jobs for 20, 30 years any longer. So how do they keep the employees? How do they keep the valuable ones? Well, they start increasing their skills. And that's what workplace development is, strengthening the employees that you have to grow and prosper with the company.
So essentially creating a heightened sense of value in the workplace then.
Exactly. Nice. Exactly.
I like the way that you summarized that definition that you found in the newspaper. I like that. Yes. So just a quick segue then, how do you best describe self-improvement in the workplace?
Well, self-improvement in general, I think, is defined as improving various aspects of our lives in a positive way, whether you're doing that professionally or personally. Usually the personal will stem into the professional life. You'll be able to see rewards, say, at home and with clearly defined goals. And even despite some of the challenges that you may come across, when I think about self-improvement in the workplace, I think about time management, building relationships, increasing your knowledge on your subject matter, or improving your listening skills, which is very important. And like I said, it extends from the personal into the professional life.
Well said. It's almost like finding meaning behind, like, what can we do to move you forward even more?
Exactly. Exactly.
It's like checking in a way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Exactly.
Do you have any best practice tips for anybody struggling with self-improvement in the workplace or somebody that just needs a little more time for self-improvement?
Well, I've spoken to several of my friends who are in the human resource world, and I agree with them. The first step is to actually sit and have a conversation with someone that you feel needs to be encouraged with the self-improvement. Okay. I don't like to assume that just because they're having problems now means they didn't have any problems before. Okay, you also don't want to assume that if they did have problems before, did they try ways to improve? You know, did they experiment on their own with their self-improvement? So I think people become more receptive to the idea of needing self-improvement if they can recognize that their own work ethic might be diminishing or that there's areas of improvement, and then go from there. So I think they're more receptive if they can see that. Some of the things they might have tried in the past or haven't tried or maybe want to try could be writing daily or monthly goals, journalizing, taking notes. I take excessive amount of notes, as you can tell. I have my notes here today because then I feel I can comprehend and visualize much better. And that's what I did for my own self-improvement.
I love that you said that. I'm in the counseling field, so we learn that technique as solution-focused.
Yes.
So what worked for you in the past? Let's try that. And if that didn't work, let's try something new.
Exactly.
I really like your whole summary because it comes together in, you know, solution-focused.
Exactly. But then you're not making any assumptions about the person because each individual is different.
Yes.
You know, showing a personal interest in them also helps them to really self-evaluate and think about it.
And gaining that trust and safety to have conversations like that. That's a beautiful thing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
What does healthy self-improvement look like on the inside and outside of a person?
Well, when I think of healthy self-improvement, I sort of think on the health side, you know, physical and mental strategies that could work to reach your goals. Perhaps, you know, eating healthier, exercising, getting more rest. Doing that on the personal level, of course, it's going to help you and in your professional field because you come to work, you're more focused, more energized because you had that healthy snack or you had that full night's sleep, mm-hmm. which is sometimes hard to find. It eludes many of us. I'm sure you understand with college, graduate studies, yes.
Yep.
But then you also have to sometimes think about there could be adverse effects. You know, if someone is too fixated on what their professional or personal image is and their goals for self-improvement aren't getting them to the point that they want to be. Mm-hmm. So then you could either have them go from, you know, actually digging deeper and trying more things and just continuously being fixated on that, or they could give up altogether because they think, why bother? It's not helping. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the burnout effect. Exactly. And I'm sure you may have realized that with graduate studies as well.
Yes.
Been there, done that.
Yep. I'm right now my last year, so I hear that when you say that. I'm like, so much time and effort spent that it's like, I'm almost there. So yes. Burnout is not happening, but I'm conscious of the warning signs.
Yeah, and then with you, also, I would think time management would be a big thing, that you have to figure out what is your priorities.
So. Absolutely. I really liked your emphasis on daily goals as well as weekly or monthly goals, too. I set goals every single day when I wake up. This way I know what my day is going to look like. Mm-hmm. I always think that that's a really good tip and trick for anybody trying to work on self-improvement.
Yes.
Have there been any pivotal moments in your life that really changed the trajectory of your self-improvement?
Well, yes. When I started, like I said, in workforce development, I thought it was solely training, okay, that enhanced your job skills. You know, computers, maybe learning how to do presentations, any kind of documentations, you know, files, things like that. I didn't realize until I started into being a workforce development coordinator and working with other businesses and helping them to define what that means, that I realized that it involves a lot of foundational skills, what people used to call soft skills. you know, communication in the means of listening as well as speaking, you know, because you really got to take the time sometimes and just listen to what others are trying to view, trying to say, rather than just get your point across. There's also other things that I think are important that I learned that were pivotal for me was diversity. Okay, understanding the culture around where you work, the corporate culture, as well as the backgrounds and the cultures of the individuals in your workplace. I think it helps to strengthen your work environment, as well as your ability to meet goals, because being a project manager, you know, you would have meetings and you sit down and you talk with your team members and you say, okay, this is what we need to do. Okay, how do we get there? If you have a strong understanding of everyone's strengths and weaknesses and their diversity and their backgrounds, you'll have lots of ideas come out and you'll be amazed at what can be accomplished with something that is just, oh, I never thought of it that way.
That's my favorite thing when diving into the idea of multiculturalism, is the fact that you're meeting another person where their lens is.
Exactly.
So there's always a learning opportunity to come from an experience like that. I love your emphasis on that because, like I said, you have to meet the client to where their lens is.
Yes.
You can never solve their issues based on your own cultural perception.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Have you, I'm going to jump over and be the interviewer for a second. In your studies, have you had any training so far as that? Or I guess being a college student, there's diversity everywhere.
There is diversity everywhere in terms of where I'm centered in my education, although I've only taken one class. It was multicultural counseling. I've only had one class, unfortunately. I would love to take more because that's been my favorite class so far. It's a 3-year degree, and it was my very first semester in this journey, and it's been my favorite class so far. There's just so many different things that you wouldn't think of when you think of a culture and their cultural norms and values.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
The statistics involved in certain cultural individuals, why they don't go to therapy. There's a lot of reasonings for that based on their history. So it makes sense.
And I'm glad you made that point because even in the workplace for workforce development, you have to think of that as well. Because one person's perceptions of what their work ethic is may be entirely different as another. There are some cultures that are more relaxed. So getting into work at 8:30, 9 o'clock, 9:30, when you're supposed to be there at 8 o'clock, is just normal for them.
Yeah.
And you have to understand that, and maybe you want to focus on them. I understand that that may be normal in your culture, but here at our workplace, we need you in at 8 o'clock. But understanding that is the first step.
Absolutely. And I love your emphasis on active listening, because I think in any field that you go to, it's such a skill to have that a lot of people kind of, you know, they don't take advantage of.
Yes.
What is this person saying to you in the sense of the music behind the dialogue? It's more than just the content.
Exactly. Because most of the time I think people, when they're listening, they're already thinking of their response. Mm-hmm. They're not really listening to what you're saying. I have a friend who drives me crazy, but she taught me how to do this. And thank you, Deb, very much for this. When you talk to her, she doesn't respond right away. Okay? She will continue to just, okay. And then 10, 15 seconds later, she'll respond because she wasn't thinking about her answer. She was thinking about what you were saying. Yeah. And that tool has helped me so much.
And it's so funny because you didn't even, I'm sure, maybe you consciously or subconsciously maybe thought about that, but consciously weren't reacting in that sense when you're talking to somebody.
Exactly.
And yeah, there's such, I don't know. It just, so much can be gained when you have a moment of stillness to process what the person's saying.
Mm-hmm.
And then say, oh, so what you're saying is.
Yes.
Or what you feel based on this is.
Yes, I agree. I agree.
All good stuff. Yeah, thank you for sharing that.
Oh, sure.
Okay, so jumping back into the questions.
I told you I can divert.
No, I love it. Thank you for asking me. That made me feel special. okay, so do you think that it's important for employers to offer training programs specific for improving self-improvement in the workplace?
Yes, and especially if they focus on some equality in the workplace, because I think it's essential to bring the workers together with the different backgrounds and the perspectives and ideas, like I had mentioned earlier. I also feel that it helps to build a fairness and equality so that everyone in the company would have access to resources. Do I believe that this is something that's universal right now? No. In our very tumultuous year of 2020, it has shown some of the employers that, hey, we need to look at this closely. There isn't inequality in resources. There isn't a fairness. So they need to step back and take a look at that. And that's some of the counseling that I'm doing right now with companies, is trying to evaluate what these challenges are and where can you go from here.
Well said. You know, in the program that I'm in, we're constantly learning about how to improve educational equity.
Yes.
And it's so important because there are a lot of people that don't have access to the resources that maybe somebody else does. So how do we equal out that gap? I think it's so important, the emphasis on providing equitable resources that anybody can access in your given workplace.
Exactly. And it starts out very young, I think. Like when my daughter was in school, you know, there were certain things that as she grew up, she just thought were normal. I mean, everybody grows up in a house where they think what they lived is normal.
Yeah.
But then they discover when they go away to college, and I'm sure you have discovered this as well, that some of the things that you may have, others don't.
Mm-hmm.
Because of resources, because there isn't access to these type of things. And it kind of opens your eyes.
Absolutely. I mean, I am extremely privileged, and I use the word privileged in the sense of blessed.
Yes.
I've been blessed in so many different ways that a lot of people haven't.
Mm-hmm.
So like my heart goes out to those people and I see them because I know it's hard.
Yes.
You know?
Yes, it is.
So let's jump into CareerLink. So I don't know enough about CareerLink, so I would just like to know a little bit more about it, what it's like, how do you utilize it, and yeah, just...
CareerLink is an amazing place. One of the gentlemen who run it, Dan Fogarty, is a very close friend, and I have worked with him for many, many years. And even just in my own research about CareerLink, you can find a range of articles. One of the things that I think was really neat to find on there was the self-evaluation of what are your own strengths and weaknesses, how to identify them, how to possibly improve on them. Of course, they had additional resources for interviewing skills, for, let me see, there was time management, helping you with your resume. Another thing that I thought was very important was not only how to get hired, but then how do you maintain that job? You know, almost anybody can give a great interview, okay, for getting hired. But once you're hired, then what? So I found that the CareerLink had a lot of resources. So I suggest if people are unfamiliar with these resources at the CareerLink, start looking on their website. Start asking some others that may have utilized it already, or look into different areas of interest and give them a call. They'll be happy to answer your questions. It used to be, I would say, go in and visit, and you know, with the COVID stuff,
yeah.
You maybe not go in and visit, but at least give them a call and find out what's available and talk to one of their people that can assist you with those kind of areas. Definitely a great place to utilize.
I'll definitely have to check it out.
Oh yes, please do.
I think it's really nice giving people the opportunity to have a platform or, you know, a website in which they can go to learn more about their yes. workplace values. Because yes. I think it's so confusing, especially for high school students. They get out of high school and then it's like, boom, you go to college, become an adult. And a lot of people don't know. I was undeclared for my first 2 years. I actually took a personality assessment, the mm-hmm. Myers-Briggs trait indicator.
Yes.
Took that, got my code, and I learned so much about who I really was without me really truly knowing.
Exactly. And that's one of the things that I saw that was very interesting when you do a self-evaluation. When I started in workforce development, that wasn't my first career. I have read an article many, many years ago in my 20s that people change their careers 3 to 4 times in their lifetime. Okay. I started out wanting to be a professor at a college. I did not have the resources to do that. I became a cosmetologist wow. and then a teacher of cosmetology, and I wanted to work at the VOTEC. Well, then they said, well, you needed a 4-year degree. And then I put that on hold for a while, and then I went into being a nurse's aide, and then finally getting my degree and being into this. With the one link throughout was helping others. And with doing a self-evaluation, you can find that strength. You can find that weakness. So, yeah, it's interesting that you had done that. That's good. That's good. Very good.
Yeah, I like that you had emphasized that there was one thing linear to your entire work
career.
Experience
yep.
so far. And, you know, it's the fact that you're humanitarian. It's so beautiful because a lot of times when you don't know exactly the position, if you mm-hmm. can key in that strength that you have, mm-hmm. it can take you in so many different avenues.
Exactly. Exactly. It's interesting to see.
It is.
And it's exciting. It's exciting. You're just starting. That's the exciting part.
I know. I'm really excited to finally get some actual experience because I've been in college for the past 7 years of my life now.
Yes.
And then I was in high school, obviously, from there. So it's like I've had school for about just way too long at this point. I'm so ready to get some actual experience.
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly.
It's exciting, though.
Good for you.
So I know that we're dwindling with time. We have about 5 minutes.
Okay.
So can you tell me the top 3 most important factors when self-improving?
Like I had just stated, the first thing I would say is do a self-evaluation. Determine what areas you believe you need to improve on. Enlist the help of others, whether it be a friend, a cousin, your spouse, or your parents, someone that can give you an honest, objective view. Okay. Secondly, set reasonable goals. I have always looked at it, and when I advise people, you know, state the problem at the top of the page. Okay. First thing, recognize the problem. Then put your goal at the bottom, your resolution. Then in between, set the goals that with each step by step to reach the final goal. And I highly recommend doing this out because then you can physically see it, whether you click it out on the computer or you write it out by hand. Then I say that to them, you know, work on achieving that. But lastly, the third thing I would say, forgive yourself. If you don't reach a goal by a certain time, forgive yourself. Maybe you need to break down that goal into smaller pieces. Maybe you need to reset the date. Don't take it as a disappointment, as a failure necessarily. And still continue with your goal. Don't just think, oh, it's all over. I missed this part. I can't do the rest. Well, no. Reevaluate it. Look at it again. Just be honest. When you're at work and you might have to report to a supervisor and reaching this goal, I would say be honest with them. Tell them what you did. Tell them what you're having issues with. Maybe working together, you can find another avenue to reach that goal. Because if you think about it, their main goal is to improve the employee for the betterment of the company.
Absolutely.
And the betterment of themselves. So
you've shared a lot of really, really great information
thank
today.
You.
You're welcome. My favorite thing that you have said, I just have to say it, is your emphasis on forgiveness.
Yes.
I think it's so important for absolutely everybody in this world to try as best as they can to forgive themselves, more importantly, but forgive those who have hurt you as well.
Yes.
Because if it doesn't serve you, why carry it?
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly.
I always think about teaching, forgiveness with
yes.
students in the future, because I think it's something that a lot of people do struggle with. It's hard.
Yeah, but not only forgiving others, but forgiving yourself, too.
More importantly, absolutely.
You know, some people are just so much harder on themselves, and it's like, you know, forgiveness is the key.
Amen. And the mind tends to
exactly.
amplify it all, right?
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay, well, just wrapping up, is there anything that you would like to share with the viewers who are tuning in? Any resources or important information that you would like to end on?
Just one thing that I found very interesting while I was reading this morning's paper. I saw an article in the Reading Eagle about building employees' self-esteem. And Joni Nagle had written the article. And I thought something was very interesting. In spite of the differences, most would agree high on the list are setting a complete vision, building a strong team, providing resources, and developing people. And she is speaking in the terms of human resources and training and things like that, building and developing people. And that's what it's about, to strengthen a company and a person.
I think that's a really strong point to end on, too.
Yes.
The development of us all.
Exactly. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you so much for tuning in. Anybody who's tuned in, and thank you so much, Angela, for being here today and taking time out of your day.
Oh, thank you. I enjoyed it very much. Thank you.
You're welcome. Bye, guys.
Success Connection on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown University Small Business Development Center.